Your Steve Jones Show podcast is loading now. The Steve Jones Show podcast is sponsored by Sunbury Motors, North 4th Street in Sunbury, and Sunbury Motors Kia, routes 11 and 15 in Hummel's Wharf. Sports talk where your voice counts. This is the Steve Jones Show on News Radio 1070 WKOK. Now from the Sunbury Motors Studio, here's Steve Jones.
Welcome back. Today's show brought to you by Sunbury Motors, 4th Street in Sunbury, Sunbury Motors Kia, routes 11 at 15 in Hummel's Wharf. You can go online to sunburymotors.com. You can take a look at the great inventory of Ford, Lincoln, Kia, Hyundai, and their great pre-owned inventory. You can select the car that you want, and then you can get a great deal on it and do it all from the comfort of your own home and sunburymotors.com. Dick Jerardi in a moment. Play-by-play call of the day. Dick and I will be talking about Michael Jordan, another great Jordan highlight from the NBA Finals.
Pippen had the mismatch. Found Jordan open. Here's Michael.
Typical Jordan on the finger roll. And with that, after massive and intense preparation, I bring in my broadcast partner for 16, now going on 17 seasons, Dick Jerardi. DJ, welcome.
Steve, it was kind of like our preparation prior to our first broadcast together.
Really, virtually the same. So, in other words, in 16 years, nothing's changed.
No. For the people that don't know that story, we met in Milwaukee the morning of our first broadcast. It was a Penn State basketball game versus Western Illinois.
Illinois State.
Okay, Illinois State, and Steve, of course, was the veteran of the group here, and I said, well, what do we do? And he says, well, I'll talk, and then you'll talk, and then I'll talk. I said, that's about it? He says, that's about it. I said, that's kind of what we do.
It's what we've done since day one. And at least there are two people that think it works.
Yeah, well, we're still talking.
Still talking. Dick sent me an article that he wrote back in 95 about which was in the middle, in the early stages of the Jordan comeback, that was not shown on the documentary last night. Dick, it was at the old Boston Garden, rats and all, and it was a surreal night because that was the night they had picked in advance that they were going to retire Reggie Lewis's number 35. What was it like being in the atmosphere of Jordan's back, but the background of and what surrounded Reggie Lewis's death was hanging over?
It was crazy. It was one of the wilder nights I've ever experienced. It was interesting, Steve, when I was watching the documentary last night, and for the people that haven't seen it, it includes the parts where Michael Jordan played baseball after he retired the first time following the third championship in 93. And then he came back when there was the baseball strike in 95 and played the last several weeks of the regular season. And his second game back, they showed his first game back, which was at Old Market Square Arena in Indianapolis against the Pacers. His second game back was at the old Boston Garden. And as Steve said, it was the night they had already picked out to honor Reggie Lewis. So it was this confluence of events. And Mike Rathod, our executive sports editor at the Daily News in Philly, said, hey, why don't you go up there and just write a story, find out what's going on. And it was my one and only visit to the old Boston Garden. They were about to tear it down. It was its last season. The Celtics were terrible. Jordan was brilliant. I mean, for a guy who hadn't played basketball in almost 2 years, it was like, I think he had 27 points that night. But that was kind of almost a sideshow because people remember Reggie Lewis had played for the Celtics for about six seasons, was a really good player on some okay teams, not great Celtics teams, right, but okay teams. And he was kind of coming in as Larry Bird was getting near the end. And then he died one day at where they used to practice at Brandeis University. He just passed away. And there were all these dueling doctor's reports and like who was responsible because he'd had some issues. It was not unlike in some ways the Hank Gather situation. There was at right. least some analogy to that. But unlike the Gather situation, this got crazy because in the days prior to this game, the Wall Street Journal reported that one of his friends was being quoted as saying they had done cocaine together many times and had done cocaine with Len Bias, and then people are the same guy that said he said it denied it. So it was all this crazy stuff happening, and then Jordan comes back, and it was really I'd forgotten about the story a little bit until I watched the documentary last night, and I said I got to call up this story, which I did late last night, and then as you said, I emailed it to you. It was nuts, Steve. It was one of the crazier nights ever. Just all these different things happening, and I was just reporting on it and wrote this column. And when I read it again, I said, "Man, it was almost, it was just a little over 25 years ago." I'm thinking, "Man," and this is pre-internet, pre-Twitter, pre-Facebook, pre-all the stuff we deal with now. And I felt like it was a really crazy time. I couldn't even imagine it in today's environment.
Well, here's the other part that makes it crazy. It wasn't like the Celtics emotionally retired his number the season after he passed away. That happened. He died 20 months before that, right? And that's what I found to be interesting, is that of all the ironies, they picked that night because they didn't do it in the emotion of the aftermath of the next season. They did it the season after that.
Yeah, there was a lot of recriminations about, again, there were lawsuits, and different doctors had diagnosed one thing, and then they said, well, this is wrong, and I don't have any inclination to explain what that was all about, because frankly, I didn't understand it then, I don't understand it now, it's not what I do. You just listen, but where I wrote the story was, everybody seemed to have an opinion and no facts, and the truth, as I wrote at the end, was just hard to find. Still is to this day, but everybody seemed to think they knew something, but really they didn't know anything. In the middle of this, Michael Jordan is in this little locker room that I think I described as like a walk-in closet. Yes. It's smaller than a walk-in closet at his house.
Yep.
And it was like, hey man, Michael Jordan's back playing basketball. And they're raising Reggie Lewis's number to the rafters. And what was the headline of the Boston Herald that day was Foul Wines.
Yeah.
So, I mean, it was just crazy. And it was in the middle of the NCAA tournament. I had been in Baltimore the week before for the final game for Jerome Allen and Matt Maloney for those great Penn teams that Fran Dunphy coached. And then when I got back home, I was going to head to the Meadowlands for the Sweet 16, which included one of John Calipari's first really good UMass teams with Lou Rowe. And Oklahoma State with Big Country Reeves and Eddie Sutton, that Oklahoma State eventually got to the Final Four that year in Seattle.
Yeah. And then later on, they had the double nickel game, which they showed. And Penn State was at the game because that was during the NIT Final Four.
You mentioned that to me in a text today. And I mean, the double nickel game. The guy's been back. He hadn't played for 2 years. He's been back in like 2 weeks. And he's putting up 55 at the guard.
Which he says, and you and I kind of feel the same way. That's like, you know, in the pros, that's the arena.
it is. I'm glad for people, Steve, that didn't live through it like we did, to get a chance to go back and see what this was like. And again, keep in mind, this was, I mean, the frenzy started 30 years ago, even 35 years ago when Jordan was a rookie, but kind of hit an early crescendo when they won the first title in 91. So we're talking almost 30 years ago. And when you see the camera crews at the practices and the games, he was such a phenomenon. And they were, and it's great for younger people to get to see how big this was. If try to extrapolate all that into today's era, it would be insanity. I mean, it would just be off the charts. And he was kind of accessible back then. And I think it's great for a 50-ish Michael Jordan to be able to reflect on everything. And I think the one thing that came through last night, it's really come through the whole doc, is just how obsessed he was with being great and winning.
Yeah.
And I don't know, in my life, Tiger Woods would qualify in that realm in golf. I don't know that Ali was as obsessed with winning, but he was as talented and as, I don't know if it was winning. He was obsessed with doing what the people that believed in him wanted to do, which meant winning in the ring often, but just doing the things he did that made him great. But yeah, Jordan is one of the you can count them on one hand in history that are like that. And he just, I mean, it's great for people to see and hear that And you can, Steve, you can still hear it today.
Yep.
He's still obsessed.
Well, there's no question. I mean, his Hall of Fame speech. Watch that.
Yep.
I mean, he's got a list. And the list wasn't all friendly, Dick.
No, it's fascinating to hear him now. What was it, poor LeBradford Smith of
yes.
Louisville?
He
invented this thing that never happened, so you could go torch him the next night. And if somebody, like Clyde Drexler, and then one thing, he just had to go after Clyde. I don't think he even disliked any of these people. He just invented reasons or ways to get him motivated. And it was, I mean, again, and also when you get to see the films and that how great he really was as a player, he could walk out there today and be the best player in the NBA in his 20s and 30s. And you put him in today, there's still been nobody better. And I don't know that there will be.
And you saw the dream team. So,
You
saw the dream team, and you had the great conversation with Chuck Daly. It wasn't really a question. It was just a point you made to him.
I was interested. I was one of three people for the Daily News covering the Barcelona Olympics. Phil Jasner, our great legendary NBA writer, was the main guy on the dream team. But I went to the semifinals and the finals just to be there. And after the championship game, I went up to Chuck Daly and I said, Chuck, because I watched all the games, even if I wasn't at them, just on TV at the press center or somewhere. I said, you never called a timeout. He looked at me and he laughed and said, yeah, that was my only goal. He never called a timeout because they were always up by 30 or 40 or 50. Yeah, it was unbelievable just to watch all of those great players play together. And Jordan, as great as he was kind of cruising through that because he knew he didn't have to kill everybody. And Barkley was actually the best player on the team. He was unreal, but yeah, there will never be anything like that again. But yeah, it's great for people that didn't see it to be able to see this documentary. And yeah, I'm looking forward to 9 and 10 both next Sunday. Steve?
Yes.
Nine and ten
both next Sunday.
Okay.
I know it probably won't be mentioned because I know that the kids will be involved at some point. Penn State offered Jeffrey Jordan a preferred walk-on.
Is that right?
Yeah.
Okay.
And then he ended up taking a preferred walk-on from Illinois instead.
I remember him playing.
It's
obviously the timing, they moved it up because people are just hoping to be able to see anything now. Because there's just nothing. What are we? Korean baseball is now one of the highest rated shows on television.
Right now, it's second to the Jordan documentary.
I know when we left Indianapolis 2 months ago, we knew it was going to be strange. I don't know that either of us or any of us anticipated what was going to take place. Though, good Lord.
I mean, for you and me, this documentary has been a refresher. In a lot of ways. I mean, it's not really anything like there's nothing new in there. You and I both knew Scottie Pippen had the issue at the end of the next game. I mean, all these things we know. It's just now I think the way the documentary is put together, I have to give the people who put it together, in my personal opinion, I think they brilliantly have done it.
Yeah, no, it's fascinating how they toggle back and forth to 93 to 98, which is obviously the last season when the whole Bulls team together. To this moment, I've still never – I know Jerry Krause has come across as the villain here, which is it's unfortunate in some ways because he was the guy who procured almost all the talent to make the team great beyond Jordan. I can't figure out to this day why they decided at the beginning of that season that Phil Jackson wasn't coming back and they were going to break up the team. Nobody's explained that to me.
No.
Yet. I can't figure that out.
That's the part I can't figure out either. And I don't know if they didn't want to pay people. Now, what was interesting, remember Reinsdorf, but I remember this happening at the time. Reinsdorf kept paying Jordan his Bulls salary when he was with Birmingham.
Mm-hmm.
Right? Which we knew. But it was interesting hearing him say, he says, actually, he was so underpaid in the league. It's like when the owner knows you're underpaid.
Yeah, I mean, and I had forgotten about how underpaid Pippen was, that he had signed that crazy contract early in his career. So, and look, that if you want to read one of the great sports books ever, read Breaks of the Game by David Halberstam. It's about the late 70s Portland Trailblazers. And even then, players spent almost all their time talking about what the guy next to him was making.
Yeah.
So, and that's become a bigger deal, obviously, as the money has gone up. That was obviously part of it, but there had to be a way to let these guys just go. Maybe eventually they would have gotten beaten like everybody else. Some younger, better team would have come and caught it, but let them keep playing.
Yes.
Maybe they'd have won 7 or 8. And it's interesting, the 2 years Jordan didn't play, I know they're thrilled in Houston about that. Maybe the Rockets, do the Rockets beat them? I don't think so.
No.
I don't think anybody would have beat.
No, I don't think so either. It was in, but you know what? I thought the way they explained the Pippen thing on his contract, why mm-hmm. he signed it,
yeah.
I thought
yeah,
it was interesting because when you come from nothing, and
it's a lot of money, man.
And you're a walk-on, and you have people at home to take care of, his father and his brother.
I get it.
He wanted the 7 years of security.
Yeah, no, I get it. It's also interesting. I kind of remember the one team I really desperately wanted to beat, the Bulls, was the Suns in 93.
It was Charles.
I liked Barkley. I'd gone out there to do a story on him. He'd just been traded from the Sixers. He basically talked his way out of Philly. and I thought that was the one team that had a realistic chance because they couldn't guard them, and they never did. And they actually had game 6-1. They were up 5 with less than a minute left. And it would have been interesting. But in all those years in the finals, there was never a game 7. It never got that.
No. Time. Not one time.
No,
in the finals. That's in the finals.
In the finals, right. Yep. There's coming up in 9 and 10, there'll be the game 7 with the Pacers. That series was wild. But they always found a way. But, yeah, that's the one mystery. Maybe they'll solve it in 9 and 10, but I can't. Because Reinsdorf would have had to sign off on what Jerry Krause was doing.
I know.
I'm just baffled by what. I mean, Jordan was how old in 98, Steve? Like 34?
Yeah.
35?
35, yeah.
Yeah, and he was still great, and Pippen played a number of more years. And of course, I actually was at the Garden a couple years later when Jordan came back and played with the Wizards.
Yeah.
People probably don't even remember that happened.
Well, he played in the Jordan Center with the Wizards.
Okay, right. Yeah, yeah. It was just kind of an addendum to his career, but I mean, why not let him go again? Who won the title the year after the Bulls were broken up? Do we know that?
Nobody knows.
that tells you something. And 20 years later,
I'm going to assume it was the Lakers, but
yeah, that maybe it was the Shaq Kobe group. Although they didn't, I don't think they won until Phil showed up. I don't think Phil showed up the next year, did he? But whatever. Somebody old. Might have been San Antonio. Might have been the first.
Yeah, it might have been the first Spurs thing, yeah.
Yeah, with Pop. So think about this. 20 years, so now 20 years later, the Bulls have basically been good for like 2 or 3 seasons before Derrick Rose blew out his knee. And they were very good. They were probably the best team in the East for a couple of years. So by tearing it all down, that's what you get.
Yeah.
Just let it finish. You ain't drafting Jordan again.
Well, they've
you
never
getting Pippen again.
They've never been close since. They haven't been close since.
Yeah, the one team that was very good was that Derrick Rose team because they were the one seed.
Yeah.
They actually lost to the Sixers because he blew out his knee early in the series.
Yeah.
I don't know if they were good enough to win a championship or not because by that time the power had all headed out west anyway.
Spurs beat them.
Sports talk where your voice counts. This is the Steve Jones Show on News Radio 1070 WKOK. Now from the Sunbury Motors Studio, here's Steve.
Welcome back to today's show brought to you by good friends at Sunbury Motors. 4th Street in Sunbury. Sunbury Motors Kia routes 11 and 15 in Hummel's Wharf. You can also go online. SunburyMotors.com. That's where you can buy. SunburyMotors.com. You can check out online the great inventory: Ford, Lincoln, Hyundai, Kia.
And also their great pre-owned inventory.
I think what you're going to discover.
Great deals, interest rates. You can go to sunburymotors.com. You can buy actually from the comfort of your own home.
Is that the one guy that absolutely knew that they could beat the
Bulls? All right, yesterday we did talk extensively about Bill Madden's story.
He's coaching.
There have been no stories that had come out.
Okay, because the players have to think.
Since the April 22nd meeting that took place in the negotiation between Minor League Baseball and Major League Baseball.
Yeah, no,
and, of course, there's been a lot of talk of the cut from 160 to 120.
He was the coolest guy in the gym.
But
nothing
Bill Madden of the New York Daily News, who's one of the great writers ever, talked about the effect on not just a revised system, but who's going to survive just this year. That you may have attrition of minor league teams just because they don't play this year as a possibility. They may have minor league baseball, but the question is how far down will it go? Will it be AAA, AA, I don't, or will they just put them in extended spring training? None of that's been talked about.
Is what Jordan did.
But then he threw in this tidbit.
Jordan did for the NBA and their players' salaries.
Most, but not all, of the short season teams would disappear. This is an exact quote.
No doubt.
Many of the New York Penn League teams, including Brooklyn, Hudson Valley, Lowell, State College, Mahoning Valley, and possibly Staten Island,
once again,
would be merged into the low-A South Atlantic League as its newly created Northern Division.
Maybe minutes.
Staten Island, he kind of like threw some shade at Staten Island because they've gone from 7,000 a game down to 1,848 a game.
Yes, sir.
He says if Staten Island gets contracted, it would be because of terrible ownership.
Jerardi, Tony Knopp, final half hour brought to you by Sunbury Motors on News Radio 1070 WKOK.
That was a tidbit thrown out there in his article this weekend where I sat back and went, whoa, it's the first I've seen of that. And I've talked to a couple of other people. It's the first they've seen of it, too. Now we wait to find out the accuracy of it, although I consider the source of a great writer writing that. Well, let's bring in Gabe Sinacropi, talk about the cross-cutters through all of this. Gabe, I hope you and yours up in Lycoming County are safe and sound, my good friend.
We are, Steve. Thank you very much.
All right, let's start with this so people understand. We can't answer questions for people as to what the future is going to be. But I want to start with this. There are a lot of reports out there and lists out there. As someone who sits and reads reports and sees lists, is there inaccuracy in what we're reading?
Well, I think there is some, yes. People are still working off the contraction list that was published in, I think, mid-October. There's definitely been changes to that list. We're not privy to all the changes. I don't think all of the changes are even set in stone yet. So there's still a lot of unknowns as far as minor league baseball in 2021 and how it all looked. I think that what is known, though, Steve, is that minor league baseball is going to look different. It is going to look different in 2021. Exactly how it all plays out, I don't think we know yet. I think we may know fairly soon, sooner than I had originally thought. I thought this may go through even past the end of the 2020 season until it was decided. But I think that things will be put together and a framework will be agreed upon, here sometime fairly soon.
Yeah, because what I found interesting was the April 22nd meeting or negotiation, however that was done by Zoom or whatever they did it. No news came out of that. Like, nobody leaked anything. And I found that interesting that there were no leaks on anything that happened with that.
Yeah, and there's been leaks from, the very beginning. I think that list was a leak. Both sides have pointed fingers at each other about leaking things during these negotiations. It has been contentious at times. Not a lot has come out of that meeting, per se, in the general public.
So I want to talk about, for a second, for the Williamsport situation. Something that has been mentioned during all of this and the public posturing has been about minor league facilities. Now, you and I both know, for example, Auburn and Batavia really struggle in this regard. The
right.
Cutters and their ownership and the city have put $3 million, at least that's a general neighborhood.
Yeah, even
into,
more than that, yeah.
Yeah,
yeah.
BB&T Ballpark at historic Bowman Field. What has that done for the facility, and what has that done to make people think that it is a viable facility going forward?
Well, I think number one, and I think you would attest to it, Steve, and you'll even attest to it more this year if you have the opportunity to be there, that, you know, the renovations that were made over the last 3-4 years, got us over a hump. It got us over a hump that we've been trying to get over for 2 decades. And it all came about due to the MLB Little League Classic. And with the city's help and our help, and obviously Major League Baseball's help, some things were done to the ballpark to where we have, if not the best, tied for the best minor league field, you know, the actual turf, in all 160 ballparks. Major League Baseball takes care of that field 12 months a year. They employ the head groundskeeper. So you know that we have a field that's as good as any in the minor leagues, better than many in the major leagues. And even the major league players that come will say that because they do not allow a whole lot of stuff happening on that field over the course of the 12 months besides the Cutters games and, of course, that classic. There are a few other games, but not nearly what are on other fields and around the country. So they take good care of it. But, it just elevated our stadium. And that said, I'll say that, we still don't have all of the amenities, both for fans and for players and the personnel that many stadiums have. So I still don't put us, facility-wise, in the rank of, a State College or a Brooklyn or a Staten Island or et cetera, et cetera. But we're much better than we were, and I think we are viable. I think we're absolutely still viable.
There's no question about that. You're still viable. What has this time been like for you? Because you're getting the question all the time, and I'm not going to ask the question because I think you and I are both smart enough that we've been around this a long time, and we don't talk in the hypotheticals. What's it been like for you, though, having to answer the question all the time? Are we going to keep playing? Are we going to keep playing?
It's been the whole off season, Steve, has been the way I describe it to people is that, in October the list came out and the Crosscutters were on that supposed contraction list, and that was like a punch in the gut.
Yep.
And while we were still bent over dealing with that punch in the gut, a pandemic, COVID-19 comes. And while we're bent over with that, we get the uppercut. It was a 1-2 punch. And we're bloodied and we're bruised. But, we're working very hard to be able to fight again. And, we were certainly hoping and certainly still hope to have a 2020 season. But, there's two questions now, right? First, it's this season, which we are 43 days away from.
Yeah.
And then the second question is, what happens in 2021? Because, the Crosscutters were supposedly on that list. We hope at the end of the day, obviously we have a relationship with Major League Baseball, with that MLB Little League Classic, and
which
and
is scheduled again. They've rescheduled it for next year, so they did do that.
Yes, yes. So we see that as a possible hope and a bridge to stay afloat with affiliated baseball. You know, there is the other option of what Major League Baseball is calling the Dream League, which is in sense an independent league, that cities will have the option of being part of. It will still be loosely affiliated with Major League Baseball. And, you know, we're looking at all the options because we don't know, nor does anybody else know, if they are, at the end of the day, going to be on this list, because the list has been ever-changing. There's lots of different things going on with it. And, you know, in Pennsylvania, we're faced with the Cutters, State College, and Erie all being on that initial list. And I hope that all three of us survive at the end of the day.
Yeah, we all do. What has the relationship been like with the Phillies? I mean, in the end, if it sounds like, I mean, that major league teams might be able to make the call on who some people happen to be, what's that relationship been like with the Phillies?
Our relationship with the Phillies is awesome. That said, you know, what is coming out of all of these negotiations is that instead of, you know, six teams, they want teams to have four minor league affiliates, right?
Right.
And unfortunately, in some regards, we're the redheaded stepchild of their affiliates, because they don't own us outright, nor do they own a piece of us. Where
right.
there's all the other affiliates, they have a piece of, or they own outright.
Yeah, they own Reading outright, yeah.
Yeah, so obviously, you know, we're the odd man out with the Phillies. And I know that pains them, too. I've talked to them, and that pains them. But I think that if we survive and move forward, and I'm confident that we will, by the way, it will probably be with another affiliation in 2021. And that's not fun to think about. We have a lot of great friends in the Phillies organization. It's been just awesome being with them. They treat everybody like family, and it was and still is a great experience. But, you know, we're looking at the possibility that may not be able to continue due to minor leagues reorganization next year.
So, Gabe, this is from a philosophical point of view. Obviously, baseball is doing a lot now through analytics and so forth, where they want to have a lot of players between the ages of 24 and 30, and they're not really in the mood for the most part, unless you're Mookie Betts or Mike Trout, to give second contracts, right, to an existing player in the organization. To me, that makes the minor leagues and development more important than ever. I mean, do you think that's fair?
It is. It's a very fair statement. I think also, though, that they're looking at, you know, economics.
Sure.
They're looking at, you know, they're now going to pay minor league players more starting this year, and they should. They're grossly, you know, underpaid, but they were looking at, you know, class action lawsuits and all these things by players, and now they're bringing that pay up, and they see the opportunity maybe to just have less of them employed, and that's what they're looking at. I think there's some things with what Major League Baseball wants to do for the minor leagues. There's some of it that makes sense. There really is. The geographic stuff, you know, it's this whole big 160 teams in the minor leagues and where they are, you know, it's just happened over the years, over the decades, right? That you build on it, people move, this happens, that happens. And then all of a sudden you look at it and you say, wow, this geographically is getting kind of weird. And it is. So there's room for geography things. You know, I hate to see for a million different reasons, teams going away, whether it's us or not. You know, I think that's grassroots baseball. That gets kids, turns kids into players.
Right.
And then baseball fans, Major League Baseball fans, as they grow up. You know, some of that's going to be missing out of maybe 40 cities, and that's a shame. But things are going to be different in 2021. That we can we can bet on.
Which was going to be my last point, because to me, marketing-wise, I understand the economic part. You know, and we just did an entire segment on economics with Tony Knopp. But part of what you do is marketing. And I think it's really hard to look at 40 cities where you and I know it. You know, the family that lives in Muncie, and it's mom, dad, two, three children, decide to go over to Bowman for a game. And they walk in and they see that beautiful field put in by Major League Baseball. And at some point they say, geez, boy, I'd like to go to a Phillies game. Right? You're now looking at 42 places across the country. You know, it could be 15 to 30. Who knows? Whatever the number happens
right.
to be. And,
right.
and you're saying to them, no. And I think that's one of those penny wise pound foolish moves, because to me, I think that's pivotal to your marketing, especially on the major league level when you're getting 30% of your revenue from your gate.
It is. It is. And those are all good points. Those are all good points. And that's why I say, you know, that removing a professional team from these cities, however many it ends up being, has to affect. It's not going to affect attendance next year or the year after, or, you know, you're not going to see this until a decade later.
Yep.
Where these young kids are not going to a professional baseball game and wanting to emulate those players on the field by playing T-ball and playing Little League Baseball. And then, you know, we all age out at a certain point of playing, and we're fans. And we're fans.
Yeah.
And,
yeah.
You know, that's going to be missing, and it's going to take time for that to really take effect. Yeah, it's going to be a shame. It definitely is.
Yeah, I mean, it's only a prediction on my part. I have no inside information, but I don't think it's going to be 42, but I think there'll be a reduction of some sort. That's just my opinion.
Yeah, definitely will be a reduction, and you're right. It may not be quite 42, and it's not going to be, you know, the all the teams that were on that initial list. But I can tell you for a fact that there's no definitive list as we sit here right now.
Right.
It's still, you know, like a ball of clay being molded. So we'll see where it exactly lands. You know, we get a lot of intel from the negotiating committee on down, and things change every day. It's been a roller coaster for us over the last few months. Without going into details, it would be really neat, I think, someday, years down the road, somebody may write a book about this whole thing that's gone on over the last 6 months, and I think it would make a pretty darn interesting read.
Thanks so much for your time. No matter what happens, I want Williamsport desperately to stay right there and doing what they're doing, because, you know, I think the world is going there. And obviously, you know, of course, you know how strongly I feel about State College's situation, too, but I feel as strongly about Williamsport, too. Gabe, thanks so much.
Steve, you got it. Say a prayer, everybody, and that both the Cutter State College and even Erie are still all in affiliated ball come 2021.
Absolutely. Gabe,
thanks,
my
buddy.
Friend. I want all three to survive, all of them. That is one of the class acts in any business. Gabe Sinacropi, nothing but the highest respect for him. Today's show brought to you by Sunbury Motors. We'll come back with Dick Jerardi next half hour, News Radio 1070 WKOK.
When it comes to car buying, there's the other guy's way, and then there's the SMC way. The other guys force you into a vehicle you really don't want. The Sunbury Motors way lets you take the time you need to browse, ask questions, and take the test drive and think on it. For over 100 years, the Mertz family and all their employees have made your experience the most pleasant one you'll ever have. The other guys won't offer you the best price for your trade, no matter how much they say they will. The SMC way is their promise to provide you with the most money the market shows your vehicle is worth. The SMC way is to offer you all applicable factory rebates on new vehicles and generous discounts. Looking for a pre-owned vehicle? The SMC way checks each vehicle in a 200-mile radius to determine the lowest price, then beat it. It's the lowest price promise, just part of the SMC way. The choice is up to you, the other guy's way or the SMC way. The SMC way wins every time. Sunbury Motors Company in the North 4th Street Auto Plaza, Sunbury, and at sunburymotors.com. Selling more cars and satisfying more customers for over 100 years.
Sports talk where your voice counts. This is the Steve Jones Show on News Radio 1070 WKOK. Now from the Sunbury Motor Studio, here's Steve Jones.
Welcome back. Today's show brought to you by Sunbury Motors. With that, we bring in our good friend Tony Knopp. I hope you're safe and sound, Tony.
Everybody's happy and healthy, my friend. Hope the same for you guys.
Yeah, it is. Yes, so far so good.
Crazy times. We'll check every day, right?
Yeah, crazy. It is crazy times, and obviously it's crazy times, especially in your industry, every industry across the board.
Absolutely. So
what has been the effect for you? And then we'll get into some of the specifics for what other people are dealing with.
Yeah, it's been significant on the sports and entertainment side. We get asked every day when we think that we're going to come back and what our ideas are. And, you know, we're involved in all of those meetings and discussions with the teams, the leagues, and the sponsors. And the reality is people just don't know. And so, you know, we're seeing a lot of different approaches to what's happening out there. A lot of people who were pretty overly stretched out with debt are really, really hurting, and I think in a lot worse shape than they'd like to let on. And, you know, for the listeners out there, you know, behind a lot of these large events, there's generally a very large business that's, you know, a multi-billion dollar market cap company, whether that's an Endeavor who owns all of the rights to the UFC, or they also own all of the rights to all the hospitality and much of the ticketing for the Super Bowl. So that company has had, you know, 30% of their staff laid off. They're laying off a bunch more. They've got a lot of debt. You know, Live Nation has a lot of debt on them. They own Ticketmaster. StubHub, some people won't even believe, has gone from 3,000 employees down to 150. So there's been significant changes in our market. We've been relatively strong as a business. We're, you know, mostly a software company, and that continues to hold up. Right. So we've been taken care of, which has been a blessing that's not lost on us. And I think everybody's just really focused on what's going to happen, you know, when events do come back and how they come back across the board. And so that's the conversation du jour right now, is how are we going to handle this? What does that look like? And what do we think is going to happen there?
All right, so let's get to a couple of specifics for a moment. We're in this position right now where, you know, somebody may survive, but in a different form. Somebody might not survive. There's some people saying right. That today maybe the Canadian Football League doesn't survive, for example.
Right.
I want to talk about MLS first. They have brilliantly marketed to ages 18 to 34, as we've talked about. But they're not the big profit machine. So nope. where are they in all of this?
The MLS, so the leagues that are the most interesting in this are the MLS, the NHL, and Major League Baseball, because they're the most reliant on ticketing revenue, right? Yep. NFL is only 18% reliant on ticketed revenue. So if they can get back, they can put some people in the suites, they can have 20,000 people in the building, they can show their games. They're not going to be in a situation where they're hurting so bad. And a lot of times what we're hearing is, well, you know, the players aren't going to want to come back unless they get their whole cut. I think they're more realistic than that. We've spoken to a few of them. We deal with a lot of the agencies. They know that they've got to keep things afloat, right? This is no longer a case of how fast are we growing. This is a case of, you know, the example we've generally used and how these sports leagues are looking at each other is like that day you were in class and they introduced the curve. And it was no longer about getting a 98 out of 100. If you got a 54, but the curve was 52, you're in pretty good shape. And that's how a lot of these leagues are looking at it. Now, the problem is you have some leagues that are really hampered by this. And the NHL, Major League Soccer, and Major League Baseball are incredibly reliant on ticketing revenue. So I think we're going to see them push the envelope and come back. The LAFC down the street here opened their training facility already. So Major League Soccer, the other problem Major League Soccer has is there's a lot of debt on these teams and on these buildings. So a lot of times what they do, you know, people think that billionaires just have billions of dollars sitting in a bank account. They don't.
Right.
What they do is they borrow against the assets that they have. And those assets, you know, to make it really simple for people, like Tillman Fertitta, who owns the Houston Rockets, he made his money in restaurants. And so now he's out trying to raise money against his restaurants, and he may at one point have to use the Houston Rockets as collateral to do this. So I think what people don't realize is what you've said already is that there are things that we've taken for granted as just normal part of our lives, businesses, that are not going to make it through this. They're not going to exist.
Well, Tony, there's another part to this, too. I think if there's one element that's been exposed in this above all, which is something you and I have talked about and you and I have always known, so this is not going to be a foreign conversation for you and me. But I think now people are finding out the slim margins with which these businesses operate. Yes, the owner does well, but when the margin gets cut, they don't have a money tree in the back and they can't take care of it because the margin was actually exponentially thinner than people realized.
It is, and when you're in a situation when you don't have leverage because you have a large TV deal that cuts you in across the board, and you're trying to grow a league. What people probably don't understand when they look at businesses that are growing is growth is taking the revenue that you have and pumping it into getting more. So you're leveraged. They call that leverage. So you have, you know, a lot of debt out there on your business as you're starting to grow it. But the minute those revenue streams dry up, people start calling on the debt. And many of these owners have other businesses, right, that they made their billions on in the first place.
Right.
And those are running into debt issues, too. And those are running into debt calls, too. And, you know, the thing that we're hearing the most, which is the most frightening to me, I kind of have two thoughts on this that frighten me going forward. One, a lot of businesses out there right now are looking at their P&Ls, their profit and loss statements, the same way you and I are looking at our credit card bills for the last 60 days and thinking, maybe some of that stuff I don't need to bring back. I didn't realize I could get it this far down. And that hurts the entire process, the entire economy across the board. Right? And I think that that's what's happening with some of these teams and leagues and how they're looking at what happens next. Right? Can we afford this? Are we going to be able to afford this? And going forward, do we even want to afford this? So that's a big concern. The bigger concern in talking to all the corporate sponsors that we talk with, and we had roundtables with our corporate partners 2 weeks ago. We had 150 executives from different companies over 5 days. And the overwhelming response was, we want to be good partners, and we believe that the teams and the leagues are going to do us right. But you and I both know that everybody's definition of right is very different. And so once those conversations start to happen, unfortunately, you sink to the lowest common denominator, and that's usually a contract. And so I'm really not bullish on what happens when we come back. And, Steve, we're going to come back a lot faster than people think we're coming back.
I agree.
Whether that's right or wrong, there's too much money at risk. We've been talking to the NFL teams for the last day. Their sales yesterday for most of the teams were pretty robust, right? There's going to be a market for this. And what happens when they come back and say, okay, we're back. We've got a stadium that fits 60,000 people. We're only going to let 30,000 in. But by the way, we sold all 30,000 of them. And Company X, here are your tickets. And Company X comes back and says, well, we don't want to send anybody right now.
Right,
because what you and I both know, what's going to happen is people say, well, you don't want to be liable, right? You don't want to be that company that sent Steve Jones and Steve Jones gets COVID-19. But that indemnity already exists. When you buy a ticket to a Penn State football game, if you had gone last year and gotten pneumonia and got really sick, you can't sue Penn State. That indemnity is already part of the transaction.
Right. All right, so you meant the college game going to Penn State. Mm-hmm. Oregon's governor, she said that no large gatherings until October 1st. Now,
incredibly stupid. It's an incredibly stupid thing to say, but I shouldn't say that because I don't talk politics. But
yeah,
no reason to rush to be first if you're going to end up being wrong there.
Let me give you a saying that I've used on this show many times, and people know it. You don't make a decision till you have to make the decision.
Exactly. Right?
Hey, that's to me what good decision making is. That aside, what does that do? Because that's Oregon and Oregon State. Now Arizona's in a different boat. Is in a different boat. We know what Washington's gone through, and you're in California. Mm-hmm. So, what does this do for the Pac-12?
Well, here's what's going to be the most interesting part of all of this. Number one, if you're Ohio State now, and you're supposed to be going to Eugene September 12th,
yes,
you're immediately on the phone saying, are we playing this game in Las Vegas?
Yeah.
Or are we not playing this game? Because I think people oversimplify back to the statement we already made. People ask me all the time, when do you think sporting events are going to come back? And I say, they're going to come back very soon. And especially people in the Northeast get very angry with me when I say that. I said, look, I didn't say whether I thought that was right or wrong. And they say, you're optimistic. No, that's not optimism that drives that decision. It's my pessimism that drives that decision. There's too much money at risk. Capitalism will drive people to make that decision. And people are saying, well, you know, in a home-and-home, like what Ohio State and Oregon are doing, you keep the revenue for yourself. If you're Ohio State, you know that 2021 is very likely going to be a far more lucrative game than 2020. We have no idea what's going to happen in 2020. Are you trading with Oregon? No way. Right, you're not doing that, so you're going to suggest
very quickly for everybody hears about guarantees. Those guarantees are for the group of five teams. When you play another Power Five team, it's structured so you take care of expenses, and then the home team keeps revenue.
Right. So it's I'm going to take all the money for this game. You're going to take all the money for next game, and that's it. And so, Ohio State, no way they're going to agree to that. So are they going to talk about playing somewhere else? Now, here's the frightening thing about all this. This is going to come down to politics. And the unfortunate thing for the Pac-12 is that blue states are going to be last to this. There's a number of reasons they're going to do it. We don't need to talk politics on the show, but this is an opportunity for that. And New York and California are going to be last. So most of the superpower football teams reside in red states, and they're going to play. And the neighboring red states are going to be open for business. So what happens when Gavin Newsom, the governor of California, comes out and says no large events in California until October, and then Arizona and Nevada say, hey, Rams, you want to play your home games out here? Come on out. We got a brand new stadium in Las Vegas. We got a state-of-the-art stadium in Phoenix. Unfortunately, those decisions are going to come to a head, and it's going to get really ugly. And the two conferences that are going to get hit the hardest on this are the Big East and the Pac-12. The Big East and the Pac-12 are going to get crushed because they're already forgotten about conferences that aren't doing very well, and it's going to get worse this year.
Which then brings up this part. The Big Ten has 14 schools, but located in 11 states. Mm-hmm. The SEC has 14 schools located in 11 states. Nebraska is different than New Jersey, Rutgers.
Very different.
Mm-hmm. Right. So what is the thought process of, all right, we're going to move forward, even though not everybody might be able to move forward?
It's the reality is, I mean, your coach talked about it, I believe it was yesterday or the day before.
He did.
That, look,
he did.
We're going to move forward, whether everybody's on board or not. And the reality is there's going to be really – this goes exactly back to the statement that we made earlier, right? Everybody's in it together until they're not, right? And everybody believes in doing what's right until they realize that everybody's definition of what's right is very different.
Tony, can I make one quick?
Have to sit down. Go ahead.
Can I make one quick point though about going in together? If you don't play, you still get the TV and bowl money because that's the structure. So actually, you are still going forward together, but you just aren't playing.
You start playing, and you lose your ticketing revenue and all that, and that's all fine. And so I think the conferences are going to look at it as, again, this is about survival. I think they play, and I think if the universities decide not to be a part of that, then they don't play. And it gets, you know, they've been talking about reorganization of the league in Major League Baseball for the last couple of weeks, how they're talking about making it more local now. And you're going to have three leagues of 10. And so you're going to have, you know, the Oakland A's and San Francisco Giants are going to be in the same division. You know, the Phillies and the Pirates are going to be, you know, all the same things. So you're all going to play against each other regularly because you're close. You know, Detroit's no longer going to be American League. They're going to play against, you know, the Pirates. So that could be a solution, and that's where the mega conferences are going to have a lot better opportunity because, you know, the Big Ten has enough teams to do this. The SEC has enough teams to do this. The Pac-12 has enough teams to do this. The Big Eight, you know, they're low on quality teams. There's going to be a bigger change. So I think, you know, like we've said before, people have asked me regularly, do we think there's going to be football in the fall? I do. We were on a closed invitation-only conference call with the NCAA. They had a doctor on there who's an epidemiologist that was not tied to the NCAA, who was very openly saying, you know, behind closed doors, I believe we're playing with fans in September because 4 to 5 months is an eternity in order to how we figure these things out. And I think you and I both know there's too much money on the line that this is going to happen and they're going to play.
Right. Which is, you know, that's really interesting that they said that. Obviously, USC's this weekend. You got racing starting at, I think, Darlington next weekend. Then IndyCar comes back June 6th.
The Charles Schwab.
The Schwab is June 11th. Okay, now that's different. How important is it for everybody? I'm going to guess that Major League Baseball is going to be the first to have an established league get going and be okay when they are going. Because in Germany, they're starting up soccer again.
Yeah, they started the Bundesliga. It's, you know, the thing about it that gets lost in a lot of these conversations when you talk about South Korea is playing baseball, or Germany is playing soccer, or Sweden's doing what Sweden's doing. Geographically, those places are significantly, I mean, by a factor of multitudes, smaller than the United States, geographically, right? So when they talk about a hotspot here and a hotspot there, there's not as much differentiation as there is when you're talking about North America.
That's
and
right.
So, right, when you travel from Munich to Frankfurt, it's a four-hour drive, right? That's not even going from Los Angeles to San Francisco.
Exactly.
And it's just a smaller place. So I'm not sure that their success internationally is going to drive anything that we're doing here. I think what we are going to see here, USC is going to trailblaze it, and I think baseball is going to follow with. We're going to play in places that are not necessarily hot zones, and then we're going to figure it out from there. And I don't know whether that's the right decision or not. Like, I believe they're going to play. Do I believe they're going to play and pull it off and not get shut back down? I have no idea. But I think Major League Baseball being outdoors, easier to socially distance within the stands. Your listeners may not know this, but it may sound crazy to them. There is a live concert on the 15th. Of this month, 1 week from today, in Arkansas, in a building indoors, which is set up for 6,000 people, that's going to have 300 attendees. And they set up, they released the seating chart. They showed how everybody separated, how there's three rows in between everybody. There's no aisle seats. That's the direction we're going. I think baseball, like you said, is first. And if they have success, then I think we're going to see what Jim Nantz said on Real Sports, this golden age of sports where we're going to have, I mean, Steve, we're going to have a situation where we're going to have the U.S. Open of tennis, the U.S. Open of golf, the Kentucky Derby, the Indy 500, the basketball playoffs, baseball moving towards the playoffs, the NFL kickoff, and college football within a seven-week period of each other.
Yeah.
That's insanity.
Yeah, and the Masters in November.
The Masters in November to tie a bow in all of it. And what they're talking about is if the U.S. Open of tennis doesn't go off in New York, they're going to play it here in Indian Wells in November. That's the contingency plan.
I heard that.
It's a stadium of 17,000 people.
This is, well, obviously, it's unprecedented. Despite what everybody thinks, I did not live through the Spanish flu 102 years ago. I'm not that old. Tony can attest. I'm not that old.
That's funny. I think when we look at that, though, you know, even there, I'll make that point, which people get angry about sometimes, but they played college football in 1918. And a lot of people say, you know, look, you know, that was 100 years ago. A lot has changed. And a lot has changed 100 years ago. But 100 years ago, we were not monkeys rubbing stones together. We had discovered, you know, Newtonian theory. We had combustible engines. We had, you know, people were intelligent at that point. They had the ability to think cognitively. And so history generally does repeat itself, and I just think there's going to be too much demand for this. And eventually it's going to become a shootout between blue governors and red governors, and the states are going to be caught in the middle.
And maybe the sports will be caught in the middle.
Absolutely.
One quick side personal note. As somebody who's rebuilding his phone inventory because my phone died 3 months ago, you stole my cell number, right?
I do.
Right. Could you do me a favor and send me a text? That way I've got your number.
I will do that.
Because if you're wondering why I haven't texted you to say, hey, you doing okay? That's the reason.
I appreciate that. We're doing great. And that is not lost on us. There's a lot of people that are really, really hurting. We're doing the best we can to keep ourselves going and then to help people that need it. Because this is, like I said, it's unprecedented, and I think it's going to get bad. I'm not sure it's going to bounce back as fast as people think.
Right. No, but shoot me a text. That way I've got it. And then the other one final question, that deals with the construction at SoFi. Is it on track to be done?
Yes. Yeah, they're on track to be done. They had two cases a month ago that they isolated and didn't spread. They've taken individual ticket sales. They started taking individual game ticket sales yesterday, and those did very well. It's one of the teams we talked to. So, I mean, even in a state where some people don't believe they're going to have live events, tickets are selling. They plan on having that one done, and they plan on having Allegiant done, and that's a lot of the conversation. When we found out about the Oregon-Ohio State thing, the first thing that came to mind was they're going to play that game in Las Vegas. At Allegiant Stadium. Or they'll go play it at Jerry World in Texas.
Tony, my good friend, great, great to hear you. We will talk soon.
Absolutely. All right, brother. We'll talk soon.
Tony Knopp. Today's show brought to you by Sunbury Motors, 4th Street in Sunbury, Sunbury Motors, Key Routes 11 and 15, and at sunburymotors.com on News Radio 1070 WKOK.